Well, we told you first and now it is official. Kraft Heinz India has signed a strategic partnership with Indo Nissin Foods to distribute Heinz tomato ketchup in India. Speaking exclusively to CNBC TV18's Priya Shet, for the first time after the 4,600 crore deal with Zydus Wellness, Kraft Heinz India MD Sankalp Podbare also talks about bringing new global products into India. Take a look at that.
With the Indo Nissin partnership, we are very happy that we have been able to find a strategic partner to take the brand journey forward, because last couple of years we had a very, very good run on Heinz tomato ketchup. Last year specifically, we delivered a double digit growth and also delivered share gain. And I think the share gain was on back of a robust brand plan, which is on the back of the share amongst handlers increase, which is the brand shares that we have gained. Now it's the time to take the distribution journey forward. And I think with Indo Nissin, I think they have a fantastic distribution network pan India. And they have an omni-channel network presence, and I think that's another bigger advantage that we see. With Indo Nissin coming on board, the kind of reach that they cover around 250,000 odd stores, and present across all 29 states. I think that gives us a lot of confidence that we can actually take the brand to a next level using this lens, I think.
So what about the kind of e-commerce reach that you have, and in terms of market share, if you could run us through how much increase in market share that you expect over the next, say, 1 to 2 years with this kind of infrastructure in place?
So I think we focus primarily on inputs, and I think once the inputs are in place, market share and growth and everything is a resultant factor to my mind. I think the first priority is for us to make sure that we stabilize the distribution with the new partnership that we're getting in, and make sure that we stick to the plans that we have drawn out. And I think once we keep delivering those plans, I think share, your contribution and everything will keep coming in, and I think we're not worried about that.
Will it be a commission structure? Will it be a royalty structure? Give us some direction as to how it will work.
I unfortunately cannot comment on it, because I think it's a partnership that we just recently got into. I am sorry, I cannot comment on the details about how the deal has been crafted.
Okay, we are in thick of the earnings season and we had a lot of numbers being reported today. Allahabad Bank was one of them. Now that one reported a weak set of quarter three numbers, with the bank reporting a net loss for the 13th consecutive quarter and asset quality continuing to deteriorate. To discuss this and more, SS Mallikarjun Rao, the MD and CEO of the bank, joins us now on the show. Mr. Rao, good afternoon. Thank you so much for joining us. First up, a word on the asset quality. Now, with your bank being in the PCA and AQR, etc., being out of the way, one would have assumed that the asset quality would actually improve. But this quarter again, the GNP ratio has worsened around 30 bps. What's causing this asset quality pain?
Yeah, if you look at the slippages, what we have shown, 2,540 crores is the slippage. Approach at the time of declaration of results for Q2 was that we wanted to contain the slippages below 2,000 crores. But unfortunately, there was an ILFS which has come into the picture, and out of the 12 accounts where we have an exposure of 1,245 crores, we had to identify accounts worth 300 crores into NPA. This 2,540 crore includes 300 crores of ILFS. Besides, there is one large corporate account which was already identified as an NPA, not one, two, three accounts, whereupon the contingent contingent liability has been crystallized now. Even that has become NPA. This was the reason why 2,540. In the 2,540, if you look at the large corporate contribution, is only 25%. So from the large corporate perspective, we don't look at much of NPAs to coming up. But there is a strain, as I have indicated earlier as well, in agriculture and MSME segment, that we are verifying properly to see that the viable units are taken care afford. And if there is any area of sickness or in any area of problem where it should become NPA, we are making them, we have identified them NPA. And this activity as well will be completed by March 2019.
Okay, Mr. Rao, hang on, we have more questions for you, but JSW Steel management is also addressing the press, so let's cut across to the management and hear what they have to say on the guidance bit.
But cost increase is more than neutralized year on year basis by the higher NSR. So our EBITDA per ton is 12,063 rupees, which is 24.1% EBITDA margin. Year-on-year basis, there is an improvement of 2.8% in our EBITDA margin. So in the corresponding quarter, we had 21.3%, whereas in this quarter, we had 24.1%. So NSR is maintained or improved. Cost of production, there is an increase, but it is neutralized more by way of a higher NSR and better product mix. EBITDA, there is an improvement. EBITDA margin, there is an improvement. This is how the overall summary of the results. The impact of all this is our net sales went up by 9%. Our EBITDA on standalone basis is 4,438 crores, which is a growth of 24%. And standalone profit after tax is 1,892 crores, which is a 68% growth. Then our subsidiaries, if I look at our US operations, it clocked an EBITDA of $4 million for the quarter. If I look at 9 months period, it in fact doubled. If I look at FY18, 9 months, we made only $9.5 million or close to $10 million EBITDA. But this 9 months period, we have exceeded $20 million. So US plate and pipe mill, there is a capacity utilization improvement. US plate mill is doing reasonably well. Our coal operations in this year, in this quarter, was $2.4 million. Similarly, our coated subsidiary clocked a EBITDA of 97 crores. Amba River made 108 crores. Our Salav unit made 40 crores. Our industrial gases made 15 crores. Our shared services unit has made 9 crores. That was a very good performance from our Indian subsidiaries. Our overseas US plate and pipe mill and the coal has done well. And Ohio and Italy, where we have recently acquired those facilities in the ramp-up phase, that's why there were losses of $10 million each in these two operations. After neutralizing whatever losses we have in the recently acquired facilities, our consolidated EBITDA was 4,501 crore. EBITDA per ton on a consolidated basis is 12,441 rupees per ton. Profit after tax on a consolidated basis is 1,604 crores. But what is very heartening here is our 9 months net profit is 6,028 crores. This is more or less what we have made in the entire 12 months of last year. We could show that in 9 months here. As far as Monnet is concerned, another acquisition which we have made in India. So the DRI units, which are 0.5 million ton, it is operating at 100% capacity. The pellet plant, which was not working earlier, we have recommissioned.
Okay, so that was the management of JSW Steel talking about how the Indian operations have improved. But do remember, the exports is what is the problem this time around because they contributed only 10% to the total sales. So we'll watch out for those details and we'll keep cutting back to get in more details from that. But let's get back to our conversation with Mr. Mallikarjun Rao, the MD and CEO of Allahabad Bank. So sorry to keep you waiting, but coming back to the point that you were talking about the asset quality, you pointed out how you had to provide for the exposure that you have to INFS. If you could talk a bit more about that, what is the total exposure, what have you provided for, and would you have to make any more provisions on it going forward?
ILFS, as I have already indicated to you, the outstanding is 1,245 crores, out of which we have already identified 300 crores as NPA, and remaining 900 crores, they are all SPVs. Around 12 SPVs are there where cash flow is currently available and the TRA accounts are having sufficient balance. All those accounts are not even SMA zero at this point of time.
Okay.
So as such, we don't foresee any account to slip further in that category, and there is no provision required even by March as well. And we are expecting the resolution to take place in those accounts as well without impacting the current SPV liability, whatever is there in those accounts.
Okay, so that was about INFS. You do not
going forward with respect to other.
Yes, sir. That is what my question was. What about the other assets and the other slippages that you're expecting in the quarters coming by? Are you expecting it to lower down from the 2,000 crore run rate that we have seen in the last couple of quarters?
No, the Q4, if you look at, we are projecting around 1,500 crores as the slippage.
Okay.
And in that also, the large corporate, if any residual amount is there, it could be around 300 to 400 crores.
Okay, so let me talk about the other issue then. Banks like IDBI have said that they will come out of the prompt corrective action by September 2019. Three of the banks are already out. Are you working with any timeline that you can talk about? When could you be out of the PCA?
Yeah, we are expecting by June 2019, we would be definitely in break-even, and by which time we will be projecting in front of RBI to review our position. Because if you look at the current status, in case of all the parameters under PCA, the CET1, we are at 7.06, CRAR 10.42, Net NPA, we are currently at 7.70. We are projecting to be at 6.5 by March 2019. If NCLT cases amounting to 2,749 crore involving 10 accounts get settled before March, even our net NPA could be less than 6 by March. Then leverage ratio, we are standing at 3.57 and with an expected infusion of capital in the month of February or March from Government of India, we expect it to grow to 4. So in all probability by June, we will be satisfying all the parameters related to PCA and we would be in a position to request RBI to review our status. We are confident of coming out of PCA by June 2019.
Okay, and Mr. Rao, you talked about an infusion from the government that you expect in the coming 2 to 3 months. What is this amount? And do you have any other capital raising plans as well, beside from this government infusion?
No, currently, before March, we are not having any plan to go for the capital infusion. Mm-hmm. But definitely, we are looking at after March to go for a QIP. Because already 83% is the contribution as on today from the government of India in our capital. And further infusion, which we are expecting in this month or in the first week of March, will again take the position from 83 to little further. So there would not be any room left for the public holding there. So from March onwards, we decide not to depend on government for capital infusion and we'll go for the QIP successively to reduce the percentage of government holding.
Okay, and if you could quantify these numbers, what is the government looking to infuse the money and what could be the expected QIP amount?
Madam, it would be very difficult for me to clearly indicate the amount what government is going to infuse. We have had two rounds of discussions already. It is in the final stages. So we await the reply from government. However, we are confident that the infusion will take place. When it comes to QIP, if we want to reduce the government holding to 75% and allow the public to hold 25%, in the next 2 years horizon, we need to infuse 3,800 crores. So we will have to take tranche by tranche. It cannot happen in one tranche. We at least 3 to 4 tranches are required. So in a sense, our first tranche could be anything around 600 crores with a green shoe option of another 200 to 300 crores for QIP, which we will be looking at after giving the results of March.
Okay, so a QIP of perhaps 600 crores after the month of March is over and the quarter is over. I just wanted to scratch a bit more about the point of NCLT accounts that you mentioned, the 10 NCLT accounts. You mentioned an exposure of around 2700 crores. Is that the total exposure and what kind of recovery you are expecting out of those accounts and as well as the overall recovery that you're expecting in Q4?
Right. Without NCLT, our target to get recovery and upgradation in Q4 would be 2,000 crores. With respect to NCLT, 2,749 crores is the amount outstanding involving 10 accounts where we are expecting recovery in Q4. It involves, this 2,749 crore includes 4 accounts which contribute almost 2,000 crores. In NCLT cases, our NPA, that is provision coverage, is currently 78%. Average haircut, we are expecting around 50%. As a result, around 350 crores, there can be a write-back once these amounts are settled. This will contribute towards reduction in NPA. Overall, NCLT, we have 140 cases. Out of 140 cases, there are 91 cases which have been admitted. So, 91 cases admitted amounting to roughly around 11,000 crores is in the NCLT corpus as on today.
Okay. Okay, Mr. Rao, thank you so much for joining us. So that's a lot of information coming in. The bank is expecting that it will be out of PCA by June 2019, expecting a government infusion in the coming months and perhaps a QIP of around 600 crores by the month of April or May.